Welcome to Royal Redeemer. We're so glad you chose to join us for worship online once again today. We make our beginning in the name of the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Before we dive into our songs of worship today, let us begin in prayer. So would you join with me? Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for this glorious new day. Lord, we ask that you be present among us, no matter where we may be gathered, in our homes, around our computers, in front of a TV. But Lord, as we gather, we ask that you'd be present among us, that you'd stir your Holy Spirit, that you would continue to mold us and shape us to be more and more like your Son. So Lord, bless us, and may we be a blessing to you. And all God's people said, Amen.
We were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. That stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old, Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise for
Hi, everyone. My name is Jamie Mitchell. I'm really excited to be here at Royal Redeemer. I'll be serving in the area of worship for the next year, so I'm really excited to be back. I served in worship ministry last summer, and so just for the next year, I'm going to be working on everything worship, trying to put things together and that kind of thing. So I'm really excited to be here. We're starting a new series out of Philippians talking about joy, being filled with joy, being joyful in all things. I think especially now that's a really appropriate message. So I'm just going to do some reading from Philippians 1. This is verses 1 through 11. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart, and whether I'm in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. This is the word of the Lord. We're really excited to start this. In a lot of sermons you'll hear, pastors start with that greeting, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where we're gonna start right now. Grace and peace. So if you know anything about Philippians, Pastor Zardy is going to talk about it a little bit. It's a letter Paul is writing from prison. He wasn't in a comfortable spot. He wasn't having a ton of fun, but he still had grace and peace and had the mindset to be able to wish that to others. Right now, it's kind of an uncomfortable time for us, but we still have grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So in this next song, we'll be talking about that grace that the Lord gives us abundantly, and that joy that follows.
Yeah. Redeemer. It's Laura Labav here, the Director of Children's Ministry, with a special message for kiddos. So kiddos, come on up. We are going to jump into the Bible for today. Now, we're going to be starting a study on the book of Philippians. Did you guys know that the book of Philippians is a letter? Have you guys ever gotten a letter before? This letter is written by Paul, and Paul is writing this to a church in Philippi. And Philippi is a place, just like if someone was to write a letter to Royal Redeemer. And this letter has a lot of encouragement in it, and we're going to learn about this book together. All right, I want to read you guys a verse from it. You guys ready? It says here, "In all my prayers for you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now." So Paul is saying that he prays with what? With joy. And he's praying with joy for his partners in the gospel. What is a partner in the gospel? A partner in the gospel is like someone who's part of your faith family. They believe in God and they help other people to believe in God by spreading his good news. Now I want to see if we have any partners in the gospel. Let's take a look together. At Royal Redeemer, do we have any pastors who are partners in the gospel? Yes. Go ahead and say those pastors' names out loud. Those pastors are our partners in the gospel. Do you guys have any teachers who are partners in the gospel? Go ahead and say their names out loud. They might be your Redeemer Kids teachers. They might be your teachers at the school. But we have a lot of teachers that are our partners in the gospel, and we can thank God for them. All right, do we have any parents, right? You guys might have some parents that are your partners in the gospel. They believe in God, and they help and support you in your belief in God, too. Do we have any parents? Go ahead and say their names out loud, and we can thank God for them. What about friends? Do we have friends who are partners in the gospel? Go ahead and say your friends out loud who are your partners in the gospel. God has given us so many wonderful partners in the gospel. They are our faith family. And even though our faith family can't meet in person right now, our faith family is able to meet online, and that's really great. And we can pray and love and support one another. Do you guys know who else is a partner in the gospel? Are you guys ready? You. That's right. Say your name out loud. You are a partner in the gospel. You are part of the faith family, and we are joyful to have you as part of it. Well, in this book, Paul said that he prayed joyfully for everyone who was a partner in the gospel with him. Should we pray joyfully too for all these people? Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we thank you. We come to you with joy today. So thankful for the faith family here at Royal Redeemer. We thank you for our pastors, for our teachers. We thank you for our parents and for our friends. We thank you for our siblings. And Lord, we even thank you for ourselves that you gave us the gift of faith. Lord, we thank you so much that you are with us, and we pray that you would help us to grow as we learn about the book of Philippians. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, a couple of weeks ago, you saw me out on a dock fishing because I really like to fish. I'm here on a putt-putt golf course because, well, I really like to play putt-putt golf. I don't really like to play golf, but I like to play mini golf, especially with my family. That gives me a lot of joy. And you know, honestly, I don't think anyone would argue that joy is one of God's amazing blessings. Joy is what makes life beautiful. Joy is what helps you with the challenges that you face in life, like a pandemic. Joy is what heals your wounds. It inspires you to do better. It fills you with a sense of peace. Today we're going to start a brand new series on joy, a series called Joyful. We're going to look at what it means to be full of joy. And it's a series that is based on the book of the Bible called Philippians. And Philippians is a personal letter from the Apostle Paul to the Christians in Philippi. These were Christians who back then were facing pretty much the same decisions and issues that we face today. More than anything, though, Philippians is a joyful book. It's a positive, upbeat book. In fact, the words joy and rejoice are mentioned 15 times in those four short chapters. Now, to start things off, I want to begin in chapter 1. I'm going to begin with verses 3 through 11. And if you want to, you can follow along in your Bibles at home, or the verses will be on the screen below, as always. But as we look at chapter 1, verses 3 through 11, as we talk about joy, we're going to begin by looking at people. Because, frankly, if your relationships are strained, life's going to stink. If you've got problems with the people in your life, it's going to kill the joy in your life. So today we're going to start things off by looking at how to find joy in others. How to find joy in the people that God has placed in and around your life, the people you work with, the person you're married to, the people in your family. We're going to look and find out how not to just deal with people, or how to tolerate people or put up with people or even endure people, but how to find joy in them. And in this passage from Philippians 1, verses 3 through 11, I want to share with you four things that I think will help you accomplish that goal. Four things that can help you find joy in others. And the first thing to find joy in others is to be grateful for the good in people. Be thankful for the positives that you see in the people in and around you. Paul says it this way in Philippians 1, verse 3. He says, I thank my God every time I remember you. Paul's saying, you know, every time I think about you guys in Philippi, I remember the good things, the good times that we've experienced together. Paul says, I thank my God every time I remember you. And that's a wonderful sentiment that Paul begins this letter to the people in Philippi with. But what's really amazing are the circumstances around which Paul wrote this letter of joy. I mean, I don't know about you, but if I were going to write a letter of joy, well, I might choose a place like this, or I might choose a cabin up in the mountains, or I might choose a beach in Hawaii. Definitely a beach in Hawaii. But when Paul wrote this letter of joy, guess where he was at? He was in prison. And prisons, you know, prisons are not fun places today, but they were far worse back then. They were cold, dark, smelly caves. They were terrible. And if you want to learn the backstory of Paul and his visit to Philippi, you can pull it up in your Bibles in Acts 16, verses 11 and 40. And you can read about how he was illegally arrested, how he was brutally beaten, how he was thrown into one of those cold, dark, smelly caves of a prison. And then he was put into chains. And then there was an earthquake. And then he was asked to leave town. This was an awful trip. Yet Paul still says, I thank my God every time I remember you. Every time Paul thought about the people in Philippi, he thought about the good things. I mean, he could have thought about all the bad and all the negative. He could have dwelt on how people hurt him and wounded him and mistreated him, but he doesn't do that. Instead, he focuses on all those things for which he could be grateful. And maybe you can think of somebody in your own life, that time when you were hurt or wounded by somebody that you cared about and or had an important role in your life. And it could have been a parent, it could have been a spouse, a coach, a teacher, a neighbor, a friend. Whatever it was, you're still holding on to that hurt. You're still focusing on the bad and the negative. And if that's the case, then let me offer this first lesson for you. There are going to be four lessons that I'm going to pull right out of this passage. And the first lesson is this: remember the best and forget the rest. You know, remember the good in people and forget about all the other garbage. Remember the best. Focus on the positive in people, because honestly, pleasant memories are a choice. Right? You have the ability to choose what you're going to remember about different people in your life. And because you have that freedom of choice, my recommendation to you is to remember the best and just forget the rest. Now, please understand what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that you should deny your hurts, that you should deny the fact that you were wounded or that people acted in a way that was wrong in your life. But I am saying, I mean, because that would be unhealthy. But I am saying that it's more helpful if you can focus on the good and the best versus the bad and the negative all the time. And Paul understood that. That's why Paul says this in verse 5. He says, "You have been my partners in spreading the good news about Christ from the time you first heard it until now." So, you know, Paul could have dwelt on the negative, right? He could have thought about all the misery that he experienced in that dungeon in Philippi, but he doesn't, right? He focuses on the good, on the positive, the fact that the people of Philippi walked alongside of him, that they were, as he calls them, his partners. And maybe you can think of people like that in your life. Maybe there was somebody who walked with you, who was a partner with you. Maybe that you can think of somebody who was good to you. And it could have been a family member or maybe a friend. And they don't have to do anything spectacular, right? It's just, they were just there for you. When everybody else was walking out on your life, they stood by you. When you were in that time of crisis, when you were dealing with that difficulty, or even when you were just being a complete knucklehead, right? They were there for you. And that's an amazing, amazing blessing. So when it comes to finding joy in others, be grateful for the good in people. Think about the positives. Now, granted, it might take some creativity on your part for some of the people in and around your lives, but I am absolutely convinced that you can find good in everybody. And so again, the first thing to find joy in others is be grateful for the good in people. And the first lesson is to remember the best, forget the rest. The second thing to find joy in others is to practice positive praying. Practice positive praying. Paul goes on in verse 4, he says, "In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy." Can you imagine hearing that from Paul in his letter? To know that he's thinking about you and remembering you in his prayers, I would be encouraged by that. And that leads me to the second lesson that we can pull out of this passage. And it's this: to find joy in others, start thanking God for people in your prayers. Start thanking God for the people in and around your life in your prayers. I mean, honestly, when was the last time that you thanked God for somebody else who wasn't a member of your family, even an extended family member? Somebody who's not related to you at all. Or how about this? When was the last time you thanked God for somebody who was irritating to you? Yeah, right. That ain't happening, right? That's hard to do. And yet, therein lies the secret to joy. When you pray to God for people, including the people who irritate you, thank God for them. And thank God for them for these two reasons. First, it's going to change your attitude toward those people. And second, it's going to change them. And I can say that because while people may reject your advice and resist your suggestions and maybe even just flat out ignore your offers to help them out, they are powerless against your prayers. So pray for them, because that's what Paul does. Verses 9, 10, and 11, Paul says this: "This is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." What an amazing prayer. And I don't know if you caught this, but there are four things that Paul is praying for for these people in Philippi. Four things that you can pray for with the people in and around your life. For one thing, you can pray that they will grow in love. Paul talks about the people in Philippi. He prays that their love may abound. You know, that Greek word abound means to be in excess. So you're just praying that their love is going to grow to the point where it just spills over to everybody around them. That's a good thing to pray for people, right? The second thing that you can pray for is that you can pray that they will make wise choices. And Paul says, he asks that God would help them to discern what is best. And who wouldn't want to be able to do that, right? We all want to make sound decisions. We know that our choices not only impact us, but the people around us. So that's another good thing to pray for. A third thing that you can pray is that they will do the right thing. Paul says, he prays that they would be pure and blameless. So really, you're praying that the people in and around your life, that they're going to live in such a way that aligns with God's will, with how God wants them to live, so that they can have a clear conscience. And then the fourth thing is that you can pray that they will live for God's glory. Paul says that they would be filled with the fruit of righteousness. So there you go. Those are four things, simple things for which you can pray for those people in and around your life. The bottom line, though, is if you want to find joy in others, practice positive praying. And the lesson to remember is that you want to just start, thanking God for the people in and around your life in your prayers. Well, the third point, if you want to find joy in others, is to be patient with their progress. If you want to find joy in people, be patient, because it takes time for people to develop and mature. And this is true for everybody across the board, all human beings. I mean, growth and development don't just, happen overnight. It takes time. So be patient with their progress. And Paul understood that as well. That's why he says this in verse 6, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. In other words, Paul's saying what God starts, he finishes. And that's huge, because as human beings, we start a lot of things, but we don't always finish them, right? I mean, maybe you have a home improvement project that, if you're honest, you can admit, yeah, I started it, but it still isn't finished. And there are other things. I mean, there's symphonies that are unfinished, buildings that are unfinished, books that go unfinished. As human beings, there are a lot of things that we start, but we don't finish them. Not God. And Paul understood that. Paul knew that when God was going to begin a good work within us, that work of faith through the power of the Holy Spirit, that he would continue to see that work through to completion. And so it doesn't matter if you fail, it doesn't matter if you have bad habits, it doesn't matter if you make poor decisions or sin, God is patient with you. And because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross, he will forgive you. As a gift of grace, he will show you mercy, he will restore you with his love, and he will continue to be at work in you. And that leads me to the third lesson from this passage that I'd like to share with you. And the third lesson is to simply remember that God isn't finished with people. All right, God is at work in your life. He is certainly not finished with you yet. So just keep in mind, he's still at work in the people's lives around you, the lives of those people in and around you. He isn't finished with them yet either. So again, be patient with them as they grow and develop. I think if Paul were here today, maybe not here in this putt-putt golf place, but if he were here today, I think that he would say something to the effect of, I am so glad I'm not the person that I used to be, but I'm also glad that the person I am now, I'm not going to be in the future, because I'm growing, I'm changing. And so to find joy in others, be patient with people now so that you can enjoy them now. So you can enjoy them now in the process, not when they finally arrive. Or you think about it. In your marriage, right? You want to enjoy your spouse now in the process of them growing and developing, right? Not later. You want to enjoy them now. As parents, you want to enjoy your kids now in the process of them growing and maturing. So be patient. Be patient with them as they grow and develop. Let me read again verse 6. Paul says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. There are two Greek words there. The word that is begin and is translated complete. Those are two technical terms in the Greek that refer to the beginning and the end of a sacrifice. And without a doubt, through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, right? The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Through his death and resurrection, you can know that the power of sin and death and the devil has been broken for you, for me, for all people everywhere. Through Jesus' death on the cross, you are part of God's family. So if you're sitting there looking at me and wondering if God loves you, know that he does. Find a cross and look at it. All right, that's proof. That's proof that you are loved by God. That's how valuable you are to him. It doesn't matter if you how sin-scarred you may be. It doesn't matter how defiled by the world you may be. You have a God who loves you, who forgives you, and who restores you, and who continues to work in you. Why? Because what God starts, he finishes. The fourth thing to help you find joy in others is to love people from the heart. When your heart is filled with love for other people, it fills you with joy. But the only way that that's going to happen is if you know that person, if you understand their background, if you take time to learn about their history and their story and understand why they act the way they do, or maybe why they react the way they do. I mean, there may be somebody in your life right now and you constantly are wondering, why is that person always being a jerk? And maybe it's because you don't understand them. Maybe you don't know what happened to them a couple years ago, or the abuse that they had and dealt with when they were growing up. My point is, it's hard to love someone you don't understand. So ask questions and listen and grow to know them. The more that you know a person, the easier it is to love them from the heart. In verse 8, Paul says, God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. Though that Greek word for affection, it's kind of a strange word, because literally translated, it means intestines. It means bowels. And I'm not making this up. That's what it means. But that's because back in Paul's day, in Greek culture, when people talked about love, they didn't see it just coming from the heart. They saw that all of the organs were the source of their emotion. Your kidney, your liver, and your intestines, all of it. So while you may not be ready to go up to somebody that you care about anytime soon and say, honey, I love you with all my intestines. And please, yeah, I would recommend you don't do that. And don't send any emails either about that. But the point is that when you're saying that to people, what you're really meaning is, honey, my love is so strong for you, I feel it from the depth of my being. That's what you're saying. And when Paul says, I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus, he's talking about God's love for you. The love that he had for people was the love of God, a love that God has from the depth of his being. In 1 John 4, verse 10, John says, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us, right from the depth of his being. And he sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. God's love is so big, so powerful, that it doesn't matter how many times you stumble and fall in sin. It doesn't matter how many times you are impatient or how many times you fall short of God's will. God loves you, and he forgives you, and he restores you, and he will empower you to love others. Just like he loves you, he will empower you to love others from the heart. And so that leads me to the fourth lesson that we can pull out of this passage from Philippians chapter 1. And it's this: to find joy in others, be filled with God's love. Be filled with the perfect love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, when you think about it, it's just a waste to not enjoy the people that God has placed in and around you. You know, why not? Life is filled with blessings from God that give us joy, including here at a putt-putt golf course. And my prayer is that as you think about what we looked at here in Philippians 1, verses 3 through 11, that you'll take it to heart and you'll apply it to your life by the power of the Holy Spirit so that you can find joy in others. So let me just conclude and wrap this up with a couple of challenges for you. First, let me challenge you to connect with God this week by rereading Philippians 1, verses 3 through 11. reread it. It'll only take about 30 seconds. But then look over those verses and see if there's a verse or two that maybe you want to memorize. And maybe that will help you to find joy in others. The second thing I want to challenge you to do is to love others by thanking God for the people that He's put in and around your life, including the people that irritate you. But pray for them. And maybe list off those four things that, you know, use those four things that we talked about that Paul mentions in verses 9, 10, and 11. Pray that God will grow their love, help them to make wise decisions, that they would do the right thing and live for God's glory. All right, pray for them and give thanks to God for those people. And then the third thing I'd like to encourage you to do is be patient with others. Be patient with them so that you can enjoy them. Don't tolerate them. Don't put up with them. Don't endure them. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, remember, God isn't finished with you. He isn't finished with them. Be patient with them now so that you can find joy in them now. All right, would you pray with me, please? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You for Your gift of joy. And we thank You for servants like Paul who write letters like the book of Philippians so that we can learn how to find joy in others. Father, I just pray that You would allow us to do that this week, to look and see and discover the different ways by which we can find joy in others, to be grateful for the good in people, to practice positive praying, to be patient with people as they grow and mature, and of course, to love people from the heart. So Lord God, I pray that You would bless this series and that You would bless us through it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, after the service is over, please take a moment to fill out the connection card, the digital connection card that's on our homepage. Take a moment to fill that out, please, so that we know that you are watching us. And of course, if you have any prayer requests, write those down so that we can include you in our prayers. A couple other things I want to share with you, just so you know, our annual missions garage sale, that indoor garage sale that we have in the August every year, that's been canceled. Because of the pandemic, along with the Dominican Republic mission youth trip. That also was canceled because of the pandemic. For those of you who may be unfamiliar with the various missions and ministries that we carry out here at Royal Redeemer, check out our website. Check it out. There's lots of things that are available. You can click on the Belong tab to learn more about connecting with God in that way. Finally, when you're on our website, take a moment to fill out the survey, the re-entry survey that we have on our website. You'll find it on our homepage, and it'll help us in planning the whole process of how and when we're going to begin on-site worship again. So I'd like to just encourage you to fill that out so we can get your input. It'll just take a few moments, but please take time to fill out that re-entry survey. And now, as we continue back in our worship, I'd like to just encourage you to respond to God's word by giving joyfully from your heart to God who gave to you first in Jesus Christ. Thank you for your generosity as you give your offerings and tithes. Thank you for supporting the ministries that we do here at Royal Redeemer. We do a lot of work, and we continue to be very busy ministering to the people in and amongst this community and even beyond. So thank you for giving as an act of love and worship to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
All these pieces, broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken, I've been set free, I've been set free. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found, was blind, but now I see. Oh, I can see You now. Oh, I can see the love in Your
your treasure in jars of clay. So take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your love.
Thank you, Pastor John, for sharing God's word with us today as we begin this study into the book of Philippians. At this time, would you join with me, though, in prayer? Let's pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we come to you as you invite us into this conversation, into this intimate relationship where we could come and lay our cares before you. Lord, you promise to hear us, and you also promise to answer our prayers. So with that, we come boldly and confidently before you right now. Lord, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Christ who are going through struggles and challenges right now, especially those with medical concerns that have gone through surgeries and operations, going through procedures. Lord, we pray that you would bring healing upon them, that you would bless them, and that they would know your absolute presence in their lives. Lord, we especially pray for those in the midst of this coronavirus, those who have been affected by it with the illness itself. Lord, we pray for the doctors and nurses and those who care for the sick. Lord, we pray especially for the families of those who have lost loved ones. Lord, we pray that you would intervene on our behalf in the midst of all of this. Lord, it's in you that we place our hope and our trust. And so, Lord, we come to you pleading for your grace and mercy poured out on us at this time. Lord, we especially pray for the family of Bob Wentz at his passing. But it's in the hope of the resurrection that we rejoice. So be with Bob's family as they mourn at this time, but also may they have that time of celebration, a celebration of the life that he lived. Lord, as we talk about life, we continue to celebrate with Melinda and Matthew Lucky at the birth of their daughter, Meredith, and at the special baptism this past week. Lord, as you poured out your grace on this new little life and welcome it into your family through the waters of holy baptism, Lord, we pray that you'd be with this child, be with her parents as well. May they teach her your word. May she grow in the faith that you've already created within her. And we just celebrate with them, the Luckies. Lord, so many things that we have upon our hearts, we lift them up to you, we place them at your feet, and we kind of wrap it all up in this prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Would you join with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we come to our kind of the close of our time of worship today, instead of our traditional benediction, I want to share with you the last couple of verses of our passage today, where Paul writes this to the Philippians, chapter 1, beginning at verse 9, and he says, "And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ." I pray God's blessing upon you, and that he may continue to work on you, just as Paul called out to the people in Philippi, that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ. Go in God's peace, experience his love, and celebrate in the joy, joyfully. Go in God's peace. Amen.
Darkness, burn away the chaff, and let the flame burn. walk the path, I'll run the race, and I will never be the same again. And I will never be the same again. And I will never be the same again.
And by the way, just a word of thanks to the good people at Buzzard Cove who allowed us to film my message here on their property. My family has played putt-putt golf here, and we've really enjoyed it, and I'm sure you'd have a good time here as well. That was terrible. Oh, you gotta be kidding me. Let's try this again. This is tough. I can do this.